Shalom, Tennessee. Welcome to episode 100. We are celebrating. This is a celebration of praise. This 100 episode is a praise offering that we're giving all these 100 episodes to God. We are giving them to Abba Father in the name of Jesus. As a first fruit offering, these will never be monetized. If anything happens and you see a pop-up or something on there, it isn't because I'm monetized. I don't know what the future of the internet's going to be, but I do know that this is an offering for God, and we thank Him for this ability that He gave us to make these videos, and I praise Him for that. Hallelujah, hallelujah. I've grown so much closer to Him in making these videos that God, hallelujah, I'm a different man, and I praise Him for that. In the name of Yeshua, I say amen. And sit back and enjoy the celebration. God, we are going to bring back some old episodes and some bits and pieces from them, from the 100 episodes that we've done in the past. But in this episode, it's a praise episode. And I hope that you can see the growth in my spiritual walk, and also in the skills that was used to make these videos. Yeah, we went from the animation of characters using Crazy Talk Animator, but it was so hard to do that and it took so many steps that we got away from it and was moving through the rotating letters and moving background screens and stuff. And so we can always come back and do animation if we want to, and we have done it in time. We thank Him for that ability to do that. We thank Him for all the gifts that He's given us. Amen. And thank You, Yeshua. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Accept our gifts. Amen. And I love that music by the 126 called Honey and Milk. We thank them for making the YouTube music free and available. We thank YouTube for making it free and available. And we are giving our 100 episodes, all of them, all 100 of them, to Abba Father as a first fruit offering. These will never be monetized. And if you do ever see any monetization to them, it will not be because we got them. We don't know what the future of the internet is going to be, but I do know that these were meant to be a holy gift unto You. And we present them to You in the name of Yeshua, and we thank You. And I hope that you can see the growth that we have grown. I have grown tremendously as a person, a spiritual person, while making these episodes. My skills have increased greatly. And so I praise You for that. Abba, Father, I praise You for that. And I thank everybody for listening and for those that subscribe and those that will subscribe in the future. Amen.
Welcome to OBA, the Open Bible Association. Tell 'em like it is. Rebuilding the tabernacle of David that has fallen down.
OBA, Open Bible Association, is a Studio 772 production, broadcasting from our home in Grassroots, USA.
Hello, folks. This is my first podcast on this new channel, YouTube, that I'm making for this channel also. It's going to be a dual mode thing. I'm going to bring you content from this channel from a non-denominational perspective that should blow your mind. I mean, some of these things are really, really interesting, and some may not be really interesting. It differentiates my channel from other channels. I'm not coming from any denominational standpoint. I'm coming strictly from a biblical, historical standpoint of what the original Christians believed. This is the standpoint. I'm hoping that this will be a blessing to you and that you will get something out of it. The truth is hard sometimes, and sometimes it's really stranger than fiction. It's not my goal to hurt anybody, but it is my goal to help build you up. sometimes we have to tear down these things that are hindering us from our learning. That can be a very hard process. I'm hoping not to make it that hard, that you can see the fruits from this and that you can sit back and rejoice in the tabernacle of David, which is fallen down, that the residue of men who are called by his name and that seek him, that he'll be found. I mean, we are mandated for that, that we have no choice. This is what we're here to do. This is our mission, is to rebuild the tabernacle of David, which has fallen down. And this we will do. This Bible study will help us to do that. When we return to what we should be returning to and not running from something with no end to the sight, we should have an end to what we are running to. And this Bible study will help us know what the beginning is, and what our end will be, and what the middle is, and that we would be able to see the big picture. In a denominational setting, you won't be able to see the big picture. It just isn't going to happen. I'm not declaring war on any denominations. Particularly, I am declaring war, I guess, on all of them in a manner of speaking. But at the end of the day, Jesus never created any denomination. Not one. So what we are doing is not recreating the wheel, we're actually breaking the wheel in a way that we can still roll. I know that's a hard thing to fathom, but we're not ever going to be able to pull the cart if we put the horse behind it. We're actually getting it in shape and ready to roll. So that we put the horse in front of the cart and we hitch it to the cart so that we can roll. And that's our goal. That's what we will be doing in this Bible study. Seems like I pulled out some of my old stuff and used to work great. This microphone, I used it in the 80s and 90s. It worked great. I did all kind of stuff with it, preaching and singing in churches and stuff. I, you know, used to play guitar and sing. And this mic has been beat up and thrown around, but it still worked great. For some reason or another, I've had some interfaces that I've had I used to record music and stuff with. And it seems like I didn't use them for a long time. I take them and I plug them up to do this podcast, and nothing works. I fool around for 8 hours trying to get this interface to work, and it seems to work just fine now, and I can't figure out what I did. The interface was never broken. I just don't know what or how. Maybe a driver got corrupt or something in my computer, and just restoring it and stopping it and starting it, unhooking drivers and rehooking it. Maybe that's what fixed it. I'm just not sure how that actually worked. But I got something reliable now that I can make my podcast with. I'm also going to put these up on my YouTube channel and also my Facebook channel. I have a Facebook page, I call it Positive Solutions, and I will put it up on that as well as my Facebook channel. And I got a animated reader I call the doctor, and he's going to read my statement of faith. My statement of faith just kind of sums it all up, what our mission is and what our goal is. But my promise to you is I will give you content and be a content provider and give you some things that will help you to learn and understand the Bible that you probably won't get anywhere else. It just ain't going to be happening. My goal is not to create a lot of followers or to do anything in that manner that makes me lifted up higher than anybody else. I'm not looking for any recognition, just fellowship and studying of the Bible, that we may all see the big picture, and that's it. Very short, sweet, and harder than actually done. We will do it. And thank you for listening or watching or whatever it is that you did. And I'll see you on my next video or podcast.
KJV Isaiah chapter 50 verses 4 to 7. The Lord God hath given me the tongue of the learned, that I should know how to speak a word in season to him that is weary. He wakeneth morning by morning, he wakeneth mine ear to hear as the learned. The Lord God hath opened mine ear, and I was not rebellious, neither turned away back. I gave my back to the smiters, and my cheeks to them that plucked off the hair. I hid not my face from shame and spitting, for the Lord God will help me, therefore shall I not be confounded. Therefore have I set my face like a flint, and I know that I shall not be ashamed. CJB Isaiah chapter 50 verses 4 to 7. Adonai Elohim has given me the ability to speak as a man well taught, so that I, with my words, know how to sustain the weary. Each morning he awakens my ear to hear like those who are taught. Adonai Elohim has opened my ear, and I neither rebelled nor turned away. I offered my back to those who struck me, my cheeks to those who plucked out my beard. I did not hide my face from insult and spitting. For Adonai Elohim will help. This is why no insult can wound me. This is why I have set my face like flint, knowing I will not be put to shame.
Shalom and howdy. This is OBA, Open Bible Association, Episode 2, My Testimony, Remix. I know that's a kind of a wild title. I will explain that. I originally made an episode 2, my testimony episode, and I used music in it that wasn't particularly royalty free. I thought it was royalty free, but there had to be something I could do with it, and so I got a copyright strike on it, so I decided to totally redo this video. My testimony is not going to change. I still had the same salvation experience that I had in the original video. It may sound a little bit different, but it's actually the same. I'm not using an animated voice. I'm using my voice. And I want you to kind of know me a little bit better. If you're listening to me on a podcast or however that you're listening to me, if you're watching me on a YouTube, I animate my YouTube picture. On the podcast, I want to use my voice for my speaking parts. And so this is gives me the opportunity to make my testimony more my own. Although I wrote down exactly what I wanted to say and I had it read for me, it was really planned out, so this is more on the fly and on the cuff. I want you to know my character. I believe this is probably a better way. So my testimony would start out when I was 21 years old, which is 44 years ago, on a fall day, early fall day, a Wednesday, in Columbus, Ohio, at the Phoebus Avenue Church of God. I was in the balcony of a Wednesday night service, and I remember the preacher preaching. I can't really tell you what he was preaching about, except for it seemed like he was preaching to a couple people in the first couple rows. I don't even think that he saw or knew or anything about me, and I really didn't want to make it in that way. I was sitting there with my aunt and uncle, Mike and Brenda, who had taken me to church. When the preacher said, "Let's all stand and pray," I stood and prayed. I prayed the only prayer that I know, which was the Lord's Prayer. You know, "Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven." You know, I could finish out quoting that, but I didn't end it with an amen. I ended it with, "Help me." That is the moment. And that is the minute, and that is the hour, and that is the day that I got saved. People would say, "Well, you didn't go to the altar when they had the altar call." I can't really help that, but that is the minute and the hour that I got saved. I did go to the altar many times. After that, people had laid their hands on me, and they prayed for me, and I sought the baptism of the Holy Ghost. I had some really wonderful times at the altar, but that was not the time that I got saved. I got saved standing saying that prayer. Maybe that's theologically wrong. It's real. And, you know, I look at that, maybe there's some wisdom in that. The fact is, there's nothing magic about it, nothing complicated or anything. It's just the simplicity that I believed in God and He gave me salvation. It's just that simple. And that's one thing that I never want to do, is take the simplicity of the gospel out of it. God is not as complicated as we seem to make him sometimes. We seem to make the way way harder than it should. That's not my goal. My goal is I've spent these 44 years learning about him. I've not been a goody-goody person, and I've not been a really bad person as far as that goes. I've never been extremely tough and God save me like I was some kind of really ruffian or whatever, and I've never been an angel where I've walked like up in the clouds or whatever. I was just basically a regular person with regular person sins and regular person's desires. And even when I got saved, I've always struggled, and life has not been easy. I've never had it easy as far as the way things went. I had to learn how to make a living, which was rough, but I did that. And in this 44 years, I did one thing that I thought was really cool. After I got saved, I met, well, actually, she was my Aunt Brenda's, the one that took me to church, her mother, Sister Nileen Terry, and she gave me some great advice. For some reason, she kind of took me under her shoulder, if you will, under her wing or whatever, and she gave me some mentoring advice that I really took serious, and that was, she said that the Lord told her to read the Bible, read it all the way through, and don't miss a word. And I thought, man, that is great advice. Maybe I can do that. And I did. I read the Bible all the way through, and I had only study book that I had was a American Heritage Dictionary. And when I ran across a word I didn't know, I would look it up until I know it, and I would read the verse again and with the understanding of the word that I didn't know, and I'd do it till I ran across another word that I didn't know, which for me wasn't a really long way in the Bible. So I read it through that first time, and then I read it through again, and I started marking things. I give myself a color code. I came up with a color code of marking it during that journey. Green was for salvation. Orange was for a different thing. I forgot exactly what I used the orange for. Blue was for the Holy Spirit. So I started giving myself this color code of, you know, what it was. I went through it like two or three different times. You know, it kind of changed the code at some point, so it's not ironclad. That's why I would say, oh, wait a minute here. Well, green was for the Godhead. I started marking things like that in one time. And orange was for salvation. So, you know, I kind of changed my color code from time to time, but it wasn't important of how I was marking. It was the fact that I was learning. That was the important part. And then I added something to my study abilities, which was a strong concordance. Started looking up words and finding where words appear and what the definitions were in the Hebrew and the Greek lexicons. I started looking at that kind of stuff. And then I got about four more translations. The churches that I went to were basically King James only churches. I got these four other translations and I started reading them. Book by book. I would take the book of, say, Titus, and I would read it in all four of these translations, and I would try to figure out what the difference was. I would look at all the footnotes and why that they were translated the way that they were. That's how I got my Bible knowledge. That, and I also, at one point, moved to Tennessee here to be closer to my kids. My marriage didn't work out too well. I got married when I was 23. I moved in 2000 to Tennessee to be close to my kids. I really did get to be a dad, and I was kind of happy about all of that. And my kids, I got to see my grandkids. They're getting to the place to where they're going to have kids. So I really feel that I've been blessed in that area. When I moved down here, I ended up a long way from people that I know and from everything. And so I ended up moving to Nashville at one point. In that time in Nashville, I got to meet people that, you know, on the internet that were pretty well like-minded and gave me some directions on studying and good study materials and good books to read and things like that. So kind of went through that period of learning again. Even whenever I wasn't in Nashville and I moved back, I still had about 2.5 hours of driving, so I would listen to radio teachings and things like that, and I'd spend 5 hours a day still learning without even really thinking about it too much. My knowledge and my wisdom grew to where I am today, and I'm still learning as far as that goes. But there's one thing that I don't think that I can outlearn, and that's the simplicity of the gospel. I don't want to outdo that. I mean, I've learned sacred names. I've learned about the Sabbath. I've learned so many different things. But there's something called the simplicity of the gospel, which I don't want to ever make things too hard to where the simplicity of the gospel just doesn't shine in anything that I give as a testimony or a teaching. Simplicity. God says it, and we can believe it. We may have to seek for some understanding, but the understanding is not going to be so complicated to where you can't find it. And this is my testimony, and I hope that this is enough of me that you would find it interesting to look or listen to the rest of my podcast or YouTube videos that I'm making. And thank you for listening.
OBA mission statement and USP unique social positioning. OBA unique layman believer non-denominational Bible study program for believers to teach the Bible at a level that enhances your understanding and encouraging your relationship with God. This is not a program for the easily offended or faint in heart. Bringing the Bible from its Hebrew roots to you may be a journey that you are not willing to make. It is our goal not to cheapen your relationship with your Creator, but to enhance it. The truth may hurt and at times really be hard to grasp due to it is not exactly what you have been taught or felt comfortable with. Being truly non-denominational means that it is not a popular route to go with the denominational Christian world. It is our goal, like the prophet Isaiah said, by doing this to receive this result among other benefits that come from God. KJV Isaiah chapter 50 verse 4, the Lord God hath given me the tongue of the learned, that I should know how to speak a word in season to him that is weary. He wakeneth morning by morning, he wakeneth mine ear to hear as the learned. CJV Isaiah chapter 50 verse 4, Adonai Elohim has given me the ability to speak as a man well taught, so that I, with my words, know how to sustain the weary. Each morning he awakens my ear to hear, like those who are taught. We are not building a denomination, we are promoting a Lehman-esque Bible study movement to do what Apostles was talking about in the 15th chapter of Acts. KJV Acts chapter 15 verses 16-18, after this I will return, and will build again the tabernacle of David, which is fallen down, and I will build again the ruins thereof, and I will set it up, that the residue of men might seek after the Lord, and all the Gentiles, upon whom my name is called, saith the Lord, who doeth all these things. Known unto God are all his works from the beginning of the world. CJB Acts chapter 15 verses 16-18, after this, I will return, and I will rebuild the fallen tent of David. I will rebuild its ruins, I will restore it, so that the rest of mankind may seek the Lord, that is, all the goyim, who have been called by my name, says Adonai, who is doing these things. All this has been known for ages. Notice in the CJB the complete Jewish Bible, which is not a Jewish Bible, it is a Messianic Bible written from a Jewish Christian perspective, that the verse is in quotes. This Apostolic Jerusalem Council did not pull this out of the air. It came from the prophet Amos, by the Holy Ghost. KJV Amos chapter 9 verses 11-12, in that day will I raise up the tabernacle of David that is fallen, and close up the breaches thereof, and I will raise up his ruins, and I will build it, as in the days of old, that they may possess the remnant of Edom, and of all the heathen, which are called by my name, saith the Lord that doeth this. CJB Amos chapter 9 verses 11-12, when that day comes, I will raise up the fallen Sukkah of David. I will close up its gaps, raise up its ruins, and rebuild it, as it used to be, so that Israel can possess what is left of Edom, and of all the nations bearing my name, says Adonai, who is doing this. I like this verse from the prophet Isaiah, on the same subject, as the tent of David. KJV Isaiah chapter 16 verse 5, a throne will be set up by grace, and on it, in the tent of David, will sit an honest judge, seeking justice, and pursuing righteousness. CJB Isaiah chapter 16 verse 5, a throne will be set up by grace, and on it, in the tent of David, will sit an honest judge, seeking justice, and OBA, Open Bible Association, answering the age-old question, what is more fun than a stack of Bibles?
Okay, this is some of my favorite Bibles here. I'm going to set this down and start showing you some of them. But I'm going to set this over here for you now. Point that down.
AC and a stack of Bible. AC has a way of explaining why a stack of Bibles are important and just what you might find in them.
Influential books that I have in my life caused me to believe the way that I believe. Probably the bulwark of everything is the American Heritage Dictionary that I have. It's a school dictionary. And this dictionary, like I said, I started with the King James Bible and I read it through. When I didn't understand words, I looked them up. But I actually found this chart in there somewhere earlier that was really, really also sort of a bulwark to my faith, because it had something in here that I never really was around or considered. But all these languages and stuff start with something called an alphabet. And this thing has a page. I don't know if I'm going to be able to focus it. It had a page in it that I've duplicated, I've copied, and it has the alphabet, like Aleph is the Hebrew letter. There's a picture of it, and it goes down and looks at it, how it's done in different languages, and then also what it would mean. It would mean ox, how to pronounce it, and so forth like that. It's like, man, this is just interesting. How it goes to from Hebrew to Arabic, Aramaic, Greek, and then, you know, the Latin forms. This was one of my favorites, actually one of my bulwark of my study books, and then it brought me to this book, which is Strong's Exclusive Concordance of the Bible. Probably everybody's seen the Strong's. It's not really a fun looking book, but look at these numbers and it tells you what these words mean in whatever language that they're in. Then this book kind of brought me from that, and I got this book here. I started studying it. Like I said, I found that one page and understanding of how things got to be translated. It goes through all these things from Hebrew to, and their introduction to the way that they came in to Aramaic script, and even some of their roots, such as how the forms were, even Egyptian. Interesting to see how that this stuff went, how the languages went, direction they went, and how that they, one time that they were tonic familiar. But anyways, these three books started me on the Hebrew Roots Movement years ago. Had to back off to try to get a job. When I started studying, my that I studied with, I first came into, well, Christian doctrines, what are they? Because I really didn't know what they were. I didn't even know what the hypostatic union was.
When I started studying, I used to say the Trinity is wrong. To be quite honest with you, I never knew what the Trinity was. I'm not a Trinitarian believer, but there's some merits in that doctrine. There's merits in modalism, but it doesn't necessarily mean that one's better than the other one. Matter of fact, I don't even know how that you could with one without coming up with the other one. The way that we have these anti-Semitic church fathers and so forth that, you know, had all kinds of strange ideas going mainstream. This is one of the books that I really like, and it's really got more ups in the backseat of my car, and I think it got wet. I'd like to get another one of these, and maybe when I see Ben Mordecai, I'll be able to get me another one. What's up here is called The Messiah. He did a book series. Book 3, I'm telling you, is just so packed with information. That and Michael Brown's were really interesting. But one of the books that I found that I wanted to get a Jewish standpoint of what things are, here it was a kid's school book, Hebrew school. I could only get 2 volumes. I wish I would have read it, but I found a way that rabbis think and so forth is just really, really outstanding. This is a whole new of what Jesus is, and I believe that Yeshua and what he was trying to say and thing. I mean, it just, I went in the Ben Shem Tov, and Baal Shem Tov, I'm saying that wrong. Ben is son, but Baal Shem Tov, masters of the good name. Anyways, I wanted to show you these books as well as my Bibles. I mean, I have three bookcases of theology and computer books, mostly theology books. These were the ones that are really, really influential to me.
Shalom. And welcome to OBA, Open Bible Association, Episode 9. This should be an exciting episode. The title of this episode is Pretty Woman and the Angel of Death. Sounds kind of strange, but I will explain that. In this day and time that we live in, we have different art forms, and some of them aren't really too spirit-filled types of art forms. We have rap music. Rap music uses a lot of the N-words, the F-words, and the other words that we don't particularly want to say, you know, those four-letter words that are just plain mean. And it's not really a good art form as for spiritual people. But there is an art form that's been long since forgotten. And I used to hear this a lot. I can remember going to a church, and there was one brother who used to do this art form pretty well. His name was Brother Simmons. And it's called recitation. He was very good at doing recitations. We don't see that art form very much in the churches these days or the assemblies. We just don't see that. And I believe that that's something that ought to be brought back, because you can actually recall, or I can actually recall, seeing the Spirit of God, the Ruach HaKodesh, moving through the people and leading them to repentance and drawing them in, and people communing with their Creator in such a gentle and fine way. We need to bring that back. I first heard this recitation in an African-American church broadcast many years ago, so I'm bringing it back and I'm making it my own. The recitation starts out with a beautiful woman. I mean, this woman is beautiful, and she has all those things that beautiful women have. They have favor, and they have, it's everything. I mean, they have beauty, and they have favor. People want them to be around them. And there's one thing that is unique to all human beings, and that is we are all appointed to time to die. There's no escape from that. According to the mandate that is given us in the 6th chapter of Hebrews, there are 6 things that we must do, and I've continuously done those 6 things, and they're not against the last episode where we have works of grace, where we have salvation, sanctification, and being filled with the Ruach HaKodesh. It's not against that. It actually works with it. we have repentance from dead works. Well, that's right in there with Matthew 28:19, teach all nations. We have to know what it is that you're repenting and what ways to do, so we need to be taught. It's not against Acts 2:38, because we are repenting in the authority of Yeshua HaMashiach, the Messiah. And it's not against anything that I've previously learned. It's actually building on that. So we have repentance from dead works, and we have faith towards God. So once that you learn what the dead works are, you have to learn the faith towards God of doing the things that God wants us to do. And that's all part of teshuva or repentance. Repentance is, okay, we change our mind. That's the simple form of it, which the world would like you to teach. But the reason is we change our mind is because we decide that God is right and what he's written in his word. We believe that that is his will and that is where he moves us from. That's our roadmap. If I put that in the tongue of the ancients, all those people that loved me and brought me up, that would be called the roadmap. The Bible is my roadmap. It's also the landmarks. I've talked about that earlier, about the kingdom of God and the landmarks that he set up, and these landmarks were doing his will. So we look at that, and we look at the pretty woman, and we go back. We say she's got an appointed time, because it's appointed for us to die. We also have the doctrine of the resurrection of the dead, the resurrection of the righteous. We have that as part of those apostolic teachings that are in that sixth chapter of Hebrews, that you just are not going to escape. If you're going to go on to perfection, which it talks about, you can't build on another foundation. And these are the bulwarks of everything else. So if there's any perfection or any completeness or any maturity or any way that you want to translate that word there, then it's going to be in growing up inside of those things that I just mentioned earlier. So we have the grace of God working in us and bringing us to not only salvation, but also to sanctification, separateness from the world, taking us out of this world and filling us with His Spirit so that we can walk in the Spirit. We have the fruit of the Spirit so that we don't do the works of the flesh. We're to be led by the Spirit. He's not going to lead us somewhere the landmarks are not. If you're not following these landmarks, then you know that you're probably in the wrong direction. But the pretty woman, this is a story about her beauty and her meeting this appointed time.
Shalom and welcome to OBA, Open Bible Association, Episode 13. We are going to attempt to define the word grace from a Hebrew standpoint. We are so thankful for the grace of God. Strange thing about grace in the Hebrew, it is Noah spelled backwards. We will look at that in this episode. Sit back and relax. Take some time away from this mundane world and open your heart to the Ruach HaKodesh and be transformed by the renewing of your mind.
Shalom, Rich here, being glad to provide audio while this animation is playing with the movement of the Hebrew letters, Chet Noon. I want to describe the movement of these letters and their attributes. We can see with the letter Chet we have the fence, and the fence marks the safe place to be in for protection, and this is what the teachings of Yahuwah provides. The anti-law folks do not understand that the instructions of the Almighty is instructions called law, teachings, Torah, and among other things His word. The blessings for walking in His instructions are beyond compare. Hebrew is a living language that is made up of living letters. We see that fence as a fence, a covenant of safety being under the protection of the Almighty God. We see the letter known as more than just a fish, but it is life and a humble person. These letters are moving in the animation, starting in the order for grace. Grace is God's son abiding in His area of walking in the commandments perfectly and persevering life. Most all the Paleo Hebrew letters have to do with tent living. A tent called a tabernacle is a movable sanctuary of Yahuwah. We can see this word for grace playing out in the book of Exodus, of how Israel was to pitch their tents around the tabernacle of Yahuwah.
Moving back to Genesis, we can see this first literature moving to be behind the letter Nun, which is the humble man who put his humble walk first and foremost by the letter Chet being the last letter of his name Noah. Noah is the humble man that pitched his tent behind Yehua tent at headlight behind it. I do not see the abstract rhythm of a merited fatal plan in part here. Seeing this letter's move is fun, but feeling him in your heart, soul, and being is even more exciting. Seeing grace is the letters Chet Nun, to make up the Hebrew word Chet for grace, then seeing Nun Chet making up the name Noah is very exciting. May you find favor with Yahuwah God Almighty, through our King Yeshua. Amen.
Emet is the tav which represents true faith, which looks to Yahuwah, God is the King, and puts total trust in Him to lead our life. That is the sum up view. The longer view in part is the Hebrew word emet, and Hebrew is made up of three letters Aleph, which is the beginning, Mem, which is the middle, and the tav, which is the end. There is so much to say here, but it is about Yahuwah, God never changing, and what He says is truth yesterday, today, and forever. It stands on its own and will always prove out in the end. In this episode 14 we will look closer at this Hebrew word emet, which is the Hebrew word for truth in a Hebrew mindset, which is opposed to the abstract Greek thinking that most all of Christian theology bases its understanding on and builds its doctrines on, which simply wrong due to it not real. It is subjective and only real in opinion of whoever says it. Yes, that does sound crazy. This is proof that the truth at times seems stranger than fiction. However, it stands on its own and will not fall.
I'm going to start this episode out with a prayer. Abba, anoint these lips of clay and give me the words that you want me to say in this video. I want to say the words that you would want me to say and make it uplifting and something that the people that are hearing can get something out of it. In Yeshua's name, amen. Shalom Kedoshim. That means peace and hello to saints. Greetings. Welcome to episode 46, somewhere between a praise and a prayer. That's where I am today, somewhere between a praise and a prayer, or a prayer and a praise. Doesn't matter which order that you put them in, they're both pretty well the same. Seems like I get the praises out and go into a prayer, or I get the prayer out and go into a praise. It doesn't really matter which way, but they seem to end up in those two different ways. Be praying for a person or for something that I need, or something in that order, and end up in a praise. I don't think you can help but to praise God. I don't think that you can help but to praise Yeshua for all the blessings and stuff that He's done. I really had a good time in my, and I'm praying for my aunt Brenda in the hospital. You know, I don't think that she's ever really done anything ever bad to me in her whole life. I mean, she's just a good person. And there was a long time that I just didn't talk to her or my husband, or my uncle. It's like, okay. I don't even know why. I mean, I got kind of in this place where I got married and seemed like everything went to pot. And I just kind of didn't go around them that much. Wasn't any particular thing that they'd done to me or anything, because they've always been great to me. And she's in the hospital, and I'm praying for her recovery and health and that kind of a thing. You know, I look back at my years, my many years, and I've seen all the people and some of the people that love me. But most of all, I remember my first love, Yeshua. Didn't even know Him by that name at the time. But He's been my greatest friend, my dearest friend. He's overfilled my heart with joy, with His Spirit, and I've walked in that Spirit, and I've tasted those good things that, God, I can never forget. And I don't want to forget His love and the mercy that He showed to me. I don't ever want to not know Him the way that I know Him. I remember whenever I
first came to know him, the glory that he showed me and he shared with me, and the many blessings that he's put on my life and in my soul, and all the hardships that I've came through. That's why I'm somewhere between a prayer and a praise. I can't help but to praise him when I get like this, because I remember all those things, the traps that Satan has set for me, and that he's got me out either willingly or even in my ignorance he saved me, delivered me from these things. And I'm really thankful and I praise him for that. Somewhere between a prayer and a praise. I think that's a good attitude to be in. I mean, if I'm looking at, you know, pray always, well, we should be praying. It also says to sing spiritual hymns and the such, and to think on heavenly things. And so when I can get that way, I'm really, really feel great. I feel at home. This world is losing all of its luster. There's nothing really here for me, it seems, but in that place of everlasting joy, I can see my place and I can see who I am and where I should be and what he would want me to be. I also see all my flaws and all these other kinds of things, and I have to say, I praise you for delivering me from myself mostly and from Satan secondly, but whatever it could be, is like, I praise you for that. Whichever, whatever, I praise you for your love and for your care, and I praise you for all the good things that you've done for me. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. I look at, you know, the Bible and the passages and the many things that it's shown me, and I think that back whenever he put a song in my heart, and what that song was, and even now in my age, I can't even reach the chords that I used to be able to play that song well, but it's hard for me to play now because of arthritis and things, but that song is still in my heart. And you know, I'm listening to other people's music and I can find some joy in it, but there's nothing like that song that he puts in your heart. And sometimes there may not even be words to it, and then there's this here thing about the hymn that sometimes he puts a song in your heart that nobody else is supposed to hear, that this is between you and God. This is a song that you should be singing in your heart just to him. It's just to him. And we are there for his pleasure. And when he puts that song in our heart and that praise that is just to him, that is something that I believe that he feels is precious. And that's why he can call us jewels and gems, and really thankful for, you know, being somewhere between a prayer and a praise, or a praise and a prayer. It doesn't matter. I think it starts out more as a prayer and winds up into a praise, because once you get talking to him, I don't think you can not praise him. I don't think that would be possible not to feel his glory and feel his love and his generosity that he showed on you, the grace that he showed me and he gave me. I couldn't help but to praise him. I may wake up in the morning, body may ache, you know, manufacture, thank you God for getting me up. And it doesn't take me more than a few words to start praising him. And then even though my body may still hurt, I get up and I feel great inside. I don't feel like I ache. It's kind of a hard way to put all that. It's somewhere between a praise and a prayer. Somewhere between a prayer and a praise. I mean, like I said, it doesn't matter which order that you put that into. When you start talking to the Almighty Creator of the universe, you may feel very small, but you know one thing, that you're in very large hands. Now, I used to think of something that a friend of mine told me, Miss Nileen Markham Terry. She said that God is big enough to fill the universe, but he's small enough to fill the heart of every man. And I just really grasp onto that sometimes when you're between a prayer and a praise, of just how great of a thing that is to serve a mighty God in that way, and a loving God. It's just a pleasure to serve him and to praise him. I mean, whenever I feel down and I feel that nobody cares, and generally that's the way that it seems to be, but I know he does, and I can go on. Without him, I'm nothing. I'm nobody, and I look at the world, and you know, I look at my family, and I see some of the ways that they've not been with him, and how it's infected their life, or affected their life, and how that they've turned to drugs and alcohol and many different things. And it never really gave them the pleasure, even though that they could be in crowds of people, they're still alone. And I pray for them. God, if I can't reach them, I've tried for many years. I know that you can send somebody that can reach them. Let them know that you love them. Let them know what it is to be somewhere between a prayer and a praise. Let them break out in praise. Let that prayer break out into a praise, into a revival in your heart. God, I praise you. Oh, hallelujah, hallelujah. If I've never put forth any kind of a doctrine in this video here that I'm making today, that's okay. That's really great. Sometimes we just need a good praise report. And I hope this is one that would inspire somebody to be in that state of mind. I mean, I could quote scriptures and I'll probably put some in the Bible time. I think I'm going to put this before I put the Bible time. Even though I have the ability to arrange the videos and the podcast the way that I would want to arrange them, I'm going to put this before. Not that I'm anybody and I'm putting it above scripture, but what good is prophecy? What good is scripture even if it has no results in your life? And so with this praise report, I think it's very important that it should be first. Maybe, you know, that's what this is. This isn't particularly an episode like we've had in times past where it's trying to give you somewhat of a sermon to guide you through life in that manner. This is probably even more important than that. If you don't have a relationship with Yeshua, with the Father, then none of that other stuff really means that much anyway. You can quote the Bible from cover to cover. You can quote it in many languages. You can quote it in all the translations that you can come up with. But if he isn't in your heart, it's not going to do you much good. I couldn't say it wouldn't do you any good, but it won't do you much good. But the whole purpose of that book is to for him to get in your heart and for that word to be in you to where that Holy Ghost can give you what you need when you need it. And I praise him for that because he's always done that for me. He's gave me what I needed when I needed it. When I started this project of doing these videos, well, I started it this year mainly to concentrate on what I'm doing. I think I did a few test ones and I made them into episodes one and my testimony, that project a little bit before, like sometime in last year, to see how that they would go, and I thought about it, but I put it into application, into practice this year. And this is episode 46, and I've did a few specials in there, so I probably got about 48 of this in here. I had to do episode 2 over my testimony, but it was done with the reader anyway, and I put my real voice to it. Although, the things about the readers is, they will say exactly what I want to say, but whenever I get to a mic, and especially then, I would freeze up and I wouldn't be able to talk and I would not say what I wanted to say and I would try to put the videos together and sometimes even mess up on stuff. But I still went on. And I think that's probably a pretty well. I mean, I look back and I said, God, I know that you gave me a ministry. I wasn't able to start that ministry before. Wasn't time for me to do it. But this ministry, whenever I was filling that call, there was no internet. There was no computers. There were no anything that you could say, yeah, there were computers, but not like they are today in the home. Only thing it was, me and a Bible. I preached a few times and I've done some things that were really good in that manner, but it seemed like, you know, everything didn't point to me ever really being able to do that. I married a divorced woman, got a divorce myself, tried to recoup from all that. I didn't want that to happen, never wanted it to happen, was never happy about it after it happened, and never really could find happiness in anything else, you know, any other relationship that I had. And I had my chance to do that, but it just didn't be what I wanted it to be. Some of the things could have probably been really good, but I just couldn't give up on that. So now that I'm old, I don't have a lot of regrets on the choices that I made in that manner. And sometimes I feel like I could have done things better, and I know that I could have, but one is I'm not beating myself up anymore over any of that, because there is one thing that I've learned. This world will pass away, and the all that's in it. And no matter how I would have wound up, if I'm winding up and I'm loving God as much as I ever did, and even more, I'm in good shape. And that's all I can say. They may hack my body off, and I'm not praying for that to happen. You know, whatever may happen to me, I know that I have a home that's eternal. I have a place where I can praise my God for as long as I want. And I don't have to worry about this mundane world. I have to worry about the rent or be pulled out of the praise. And that's the thing about the praise and the prayer. You can be in the prayer, you can be in the praise, and this mundane world will try to pull you back into the prayer and pull you out of the praise and pull you back into the prayer. But any way that you go, it's still a struggle that you're going to have to face. I mean, sometimes some of the things that will pull you out of the praise and the prayer. Because we're talking about this in a spiritual manner, in this power of the Ruach HaKodesh. So it's the spirit. Sometimes, like I'm saying, it could be, I got a pain, got to use the bathroom, got to do this, got to do that. No, you don't particularly have to do anything. You can keep your mind and your heart on Yeshua no matter what you're doing. You can keep your mind in praise. But it's hard. It's a struggle to be that way. And so, you know, sometimes you're not between that praise and the prayer. You're not between that prayer and the praise. You're in the mundane, trying to break out into a prayer. Whether it would be, well, let's see, maybe I can get some breakfast. Maybe I got to put this together. Maybe I got to do that. Your mind can wander and drift and everything. But one thing is for certain. He loves us even though he knows that we're nothing but flesh. He knows that we're subject to yield to that flesh with the needs of that flesh. And he even tries to provide those things for us. But eventually this time will run out. And so what we do learn and what we do is the most important thing is having a relationship with him. Having his love in us and his word in us, that is more important. That is what he calls precious as gold. And like I said, there's praises that you can offer. God, he gives us the gift of speaking in tongues, and he gives us all this stuff. But he's given some people great talent to where that they can share. But there is still something that he wants for himself. He wants that one word that you say in prayer that comes directly out of your heart. You may pray for hours, but that one word is the prayer. And that prayer, you may not know, probably won't know what that word is that he will cherish and that he will latch on to. And there may be things in song that those praises that you give to him that his ears are only meant to hear. Just like there's things that he will tell you that only your ears are meant to hear. God, I've heard your voice. I know your word. I know who you are. And I praise you for all of that. And I'm going to end that with this right now. God, Father, Abba, for the people that's out there today, give them that personal word. And God, give them and let them know that you want a personal word from them. You want to know their heart, and you will share your heart with them. This is what this means, where I stand at the door and knock. If any man open, I will come in and sup with him. I will have a meal with him. We'll fellowship with him. This is what he's talking about, where he can live in the hearts of everybody. He can live in the hearts of every person. Oh, hallelujah, hallelujah. Praise your name. I praise your name, Lord. I praise your name. Hallelujah, hallelujah. God, I thank you for anybody that will hear this and everybody that hears this. May it be an encouragement for them to seek you and to find you and to have that relationship that I won't know about, but you will know about. God, that you will share your heart with them and they with you. Amen and amen.
Do you know what time it is? Bible time. It's time to get out this Bible, open up the books, and start reading some scripture, and let the kingdom of God come into your soul. It's Bible time. Get all excited, folks. It's Bible time. Let's have some reading of the Word.
Our reading today will be from the Tanakh, the part called the Writings, otherwise known in Christian terms as the Old Testament. 2 Samuel chapter 22 verse 47, The Lord liveth, and blessed be my rock, and exalted be the God of the rock of my salvation. 1 Kings chapter 1 verse 48, And also thus said the king, Blessed be the Lord God of Israel, which hath given one to sit on my throne this day, mine eyes even seeing it. 1 Kings chapter 8 verse 15, And he said, Blessed be the Lord God of Israel, which spake with his mouth unto David my father, and hath with his hand fulfilled it, saying, 1 Kings chapter 8 verse 56, Blessed be the Lord, that hath given rest unto his people Israel, according to all that he promised. There hath not failed one word of all his good promise, which he promised by the hand of Moses his servant. 1 Kings chapter 10 verse 9, Blessed be the Lord thy God, which delighted in thee, to set thee on the throne of Israel, because the Lord loved Israel forever, therefore made he thee king, to do judgment and justice. 1 Chronicles chapter 16 verse 36, Blessed be the Lord God of Israel forever and ever. And all the people said, Amen, and praised the Lord. Psalms chapter 106 verse 8, Blessed be the Lord God of Israel from everlasting to everlasting. And let all the people say, Amen, praise ye the Lord. Psalms chapter 72 verse 19, And blessed be his glorious name forever, and let the whole earth be filled with his glory. Amen and amen. Psalms chapter 66 verse 20, Blessed be God, which hath not turned away my prayer, nor his mercy from me. Psalms chapter 68 verse 19, Blessed be the Lord, who daily loadeth us with benefits, even the God of our salvation. Selah. Shalom Kedeshim, welcome to episode 045. This is a hard title, we know. It is a great follow-up for the 7 things God hates. God not being a respecter of persons, even woke folks. It was hard enough to explain this with just common classes of people. Now with new mundane classes of people, this episode may step on toes. We would want you to know, first of all, God is a God of love and mercy. We tell you how to obtain His love and mercy. It is no big secret. Repent and turn to Him and away from sin. It will be Open Bible Associations. Pleasure to explain this to you in a way you can understand what is being said by the words, not a respecter of persons. I think you will enjoy it. Our intro prayer is, Abba, Father, open the hearts of the listeners and let them understand this message today. To some folks it may be the most important message they ever will hear. To others may be a confirmation of what they already believe, and to others it may be just something else they disagree with. Father, you know how to open the hearts to people whoever they are. We praise you for that. In Yeshua's name, oh hallelujah, amen and amen. Shalom Kedeshim, welcome to this episode 070 today, with a little sidestep as to where we would have liked to have went. The news today is disturbing on so many levels. We are only going to look at them from a few of them, not as a doctor, but as a person that experiences life on a daily basis, of what we can make out of what we see today. This is why we have a question mark on the end of your title, News of Today. We feel it is subjective to how you would want to hear it. We know we cannot believe the news media of today, and we have to filter about everything we hear, what is being said today, and what is the real purpose of what is being said. It gets to be tricky. I thank God for His Ruach HaKodesh, His Holy Spirit, for His guidance through all of this, that gives our own human spirits an ear to hear and the ability to process this information of today for ourselves.
Shalom Kedeshim. Welcome to episode 080, The Death of the Megachurch. Da-dum!
Shalom, folks. That was a little teaser from AC's Corner. In this episode 080, third week of lockdown, how are you feeling now? The majority are not going to be sick. We feel for and pray for the ones that are. However, a new day is upon us all. I got a feeling that this social distancing will bring us even closer together, which is not the goal of the evil one. Like I was taught, the kingdom of God is a pressing way. We have to press our way into it. Now we see what that means. Here is another teaser from AC's message today. Sit back and enjoy. Shalom.
Father, our Father, which art in heaven, holy and hallowed is your name. Your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. And we thank you for this day and for the bread that you have fed us with. And we thank you that, Lord, you've forgiven us our sins, and Lord, we forgive others of their sin. And we thank you for the knowledge of you and for the good word of God that you put in our hearts and the abilities that you gave us. You gave us every gift is available to us in your spirit. In Yeshua's name, amen.
Shalom, and howdy friends, and fellow saints, of Yeshua our King. Welcome, to episode 093, the time of the intercessors. This should be a jaw-dropping episode, living you marvel, at just where we fit into the Bible, in this lawless evil day, we are living in. On knowing what, our calling is, in this day. Sit back, and enjoy. Father, Abba, we come to you today, asking you to send your Holy Ghost on all those that will hear this message today. Give them the understanding of what is being said today. Give them your Spirit for them to be able to stand in this day. To be that holy intercessors that will end up in your great multitude in heaven. That will serve you night and day forever. We love you and want all this craziness of lawlessness to stop. In Yeshua's name. Amen and Amen.
Shalom, Kedeshi, saints, peace, saints. Welcome to episode 97, Breaking the Conley Family Curse. This is an episode that I'm going to explain what the family curse was and how that it came upon me and my brothers and how that I broke it. Sit back and enjoy, and Father, I pray in the name of Yeshua that you give some understanding to this in a way that is not offensive to anybody, but a way that would reflect the importance of the things that we do, the importance of how that we live our life, and how that we can leave a good heritage for our children and for their children and for those children after us. We pray this in the name of Yeshua. Amen.
More abundant life. Welcome and shalom for this 099 episode about this subject of what we call the more abundant life, spoken to us directly out of the mouth of Yeshua our King and Savior, as recorded in the Gospel of John chapter 10. How this blessing was bought not with gold or silver, but with the precious blood of Messiah, Yeshua. Peter in his first letter talked about it. He got it from Moshe, who was getting our bill or rights directly from Yeshua our Father. We see how the more abundant life fits to us believers in this episode, and our instructions to be holy as he is holy. This great life came at a very high price. This grace was hid, and Peter reveals it to us in his letter. It had been hid in ages past. It is being ready to be fulfilled in our day. Stay tuned.
We'll be right back.
Shalom, hallelujah. We are so glad you was here with us in this episode. We hope that this program has been a blessing to you, that we have given you some time to take your mind off this complicated, mundane, wicked world, and to take you to the sacred and Kodesh, Kingdom of God, if only for this moment in time in the spirit, the Ruach HaKodesh. If you have any topics or concerns, you can find our links to our Positive Solutions, Feel My Better Facebook page. Drop us a line there. Our link to all our endeavors can be found at our website, studio772.com. If we have been a blessing to you, give us a like and subscribe. We would love to hear from you. As always, thank you for listening. May the Almighty keep you, protect and guide you, and give you Shalom, Yeshua's peace that passes all understanding. We pray this prayer in Yeshua's authority. Amen.
OBA, Open Bible Association, is a Studio 772 production, broadcasting from our home in Grassroots, USA.